Hi everyone, my name is Lorenzo Masoero. I'm a PhD student in computer science at MIT. And today I will talk to you about some work I've been doing with my advisor Tamara Broderick, as well as co-authors Federico Camerlenghi at the University of Milan and Stefano Favaro at the University of Turin. Several biological fields have witnessed an explosion in the quality of available data in recent years due to technological breakthroughs. While some datasets are also growing in size, not all datasets are large. Consider, for example, non-model organisms, rare cancers, or precision medicine. In all these settings, it's often the case that we have very limited data, and that collecting more data is an expensive procedure that requires careful tuning if we want to make the most out of an available budget. In this talk, I will focus on genomics and develop a Bayesian nonparametric-inspired approach to guide the design of a future experiment so to maximize, under a fixed budget, the number of future genomic variants to be discovered. Modern datasets provide extremely fine-grained details about individual genomic sequences. We can now investigate and understand the role and behavior of rare functional genomic variants. Now, I'll get in more detail about what I mean by genomic variant, but for the moment, let me just mention that these variants are of extreme interest and importance in several contexts: for the development of cancer, for the understanding of rare genetic diseases, as well as for the study of non-model organisms. And the setup that I'm going to consider is the common one in which we have already collected and have access to a pilot study, and we are interested in understanding how to optimally design a future study under a fixed budget. Intuitively, a new follow-up dataset is going to be valuable and informative if it helps uncover yet unobserved features of the population under study. Therefore, we quantify the usefulness of a new study through the lens of the number of new rare variants that it will help uncover. The new problem that our methodology solves is the following. While there exist methods in the literature which consider the problem of predicting the number of new variants that are going to be observed under the same exact experimental conditions, no existing method works when experimental conditions are changing. And the reason why this is a major limitation is twofold. On one hand, the same exact conditions might be hard or impossible to replicate. For example, because of technological constraints, maybe you're using a different machine to collect your samples. Moreover, if the goal is to maximize the usefulness of a future study, it might be the case that as experimenters, we would like to change these conditions so to obtain a more informative follow-up. Our solution is to provide the first method to guide optimal experimental design when conditions are allowed to change between the pilot and the follow-up. I will now dive into some biological background to make my statements more precise. In modern genomic datasets, we observe individual genomic sequences, and here's a sketch of one such sequence. The atomic unit of the sequence is a base or nucleotide, and fixed positions on the sequence identifying genes make up genomic loci. Different sequences can have specific expression of alleles for the same locus. Another input of the problem is a standardized ideal genomic sequence for the population under study, the so-called reference genome. For every sequence and for every locus, we can compare the expression on that locus to the one of the reference, so to create a binary encoded variation. So here, for example, the expression of the first locus coincides for both sequences, and the same is true for the second locus. However, the third locus differs. We can keep on performing this comparison for every locus, so to create a map of variation, and we say that a variant is called whenever the allele differs from the reference. Cryptorially, we encode this information in a binary vector in which every square represents a locus, and the square is black whenever variation is observed. If we perform this comparison for every observation for every genomic locus, we end up with a sparse binary matrix in which the rows are the individuals and the columns are the genomic loci. For this talk, rather than considering this exact matrix, we're going to be considering a permuted version of it, the so-called left-ordered form, in which columns are sorted by order of appearance. In this way, we destroy all the spatial information about the genome, but we see immediately that the columns intuitively quantify a rate of growth in the number of observed variants. Our goals then will be to predict the number of variants both in the standard setting in which the experimental conditions are kept constant, as well as the more challenging, irrealistic one, in which conditions are allowed to change between the pilot and the follow-up. Last, we'll use this predictor to inform optimal experimental design. And so far I've mentioned that experimental conditions can change, but I've not explained what I really mean by that. Collecting genomic samples is a complex, expensive, noisy process, in which the final output depends on a large number of parameters that experimenters can tweak and modify. One crucial aspect of the sampling process is the choice of the sequencing depth or coverage, henceforth denoted by lambda. Intuitively, the scalar parameter quantifies how accurate the measurements made are. A higher depth implies higher quality samples, but also more cost and use of resources for every observation. A lower depth, vice versa, will lead to coarser and noisier measurements, will be cheaper. So under a fixed budget, therefore, we'll have to make a choice between a complex trade-off, fewer higher quality samples or more lower quality samples. To address the previous questions, we adopt a Bayesian nonparametric approach. Bayesian nonparametric models are known to grow in complexity as more data is collected. And because we are thinking of variants as features that keep on being uncovered from the population, a BNP model seems like a natural choice. Moreover, the Indian Buffet process, or IBP, is a standard tool within the BNP toolbox. It is indeed a prior for equivalence classes of left-ordered form binary matrices. And a sample from the IBP looks like something like this. On the rows, we have the samples, and on the columns, the distinct variants in left-ordered form. If we invert the axis and count the number of variants on the y-axis as a function of the number of samples on the x-axis, we immediately see that every draw from the IBP induces an ever-increasing number of variants. So our approach will be to fit this curve by learning the parameters of the IBP. These are three scalars parameters that control the shape of this curve. One issue of the IBP is that it is a stationary model. That is, it is inadequate for changing experimental conditions. Here, we fix this issue. We provide prediction under fixed experimental conditions using the posterior predictive of the IBP. But we also developed a new model and prediction for the case in which the experimental conditions are allowed to change. Last, we use these predictions to inform optimal experimental design, our original goal. I will now briefly sketch the theoretical contributions of this work. First, we characterize the posterior predictive of the IBP under stationarity. If we have n observations and want to extrapolate up to a total of n plus m new observations, we can use the posterior predictive of the number of unseen variants from n up to n plus m additional samples, conditioning on what we have observed so far. This is a Poisson distributed random quantity and depends only on five parameters: the initial sample size, n, the extrapolation size, m, as well as the three original parameters of the IBP. Moreover, we prove the almost sure behavior for the quantity of new variants when the data is generated from the model. U and m grows almost surely as a function of m in this way, that is to say, it scales like m to the power sigma, where sigma is a value between 0 and 1. And we can also prove a CLP for the same quantity. Importantly, we notice that the IBP accommodates explicitly power law type of behavior in the rate of growth of the number of variants. And this turns out to be a crucial feature of our model, since it is exactly the type of behavior observed in the data. And I'd like to make a quick remark about uncertainty quantification. While Bayesian models are typically appreciated for their usefulness in uncertainty quantification, our model suffers from narrow posterior uncertainty. This is due to model misspecification. In our experiments, we adopt a subsampling approach, which allows us to get calibrated uncertainty quantification. We also extend the previous results to the non-stationary case. The posterior predictive is still Poisson distributed, as displayed here, but now the parameter depends on the same five quantities as before, as well as the original sequencing study depth, lambda pilot, and the follow-up study depth, lambda follow. Transformation G is known and easy to compute, but it's omitted here for brevity. You can check out the paper for more details. Last, we characterize the problem of optimal experimental design. For a fixed budget P and a cost function C, increasing both in the number of samples M and the sequencing depth lambda, we use the expected number of new variants observed as an objective value to be maximized under the budget constraint. Let me now show some experimental results. And we here focus on the gnomAD dataset, the largest public human genomic database publicly released by the Broad in 2019. We here focus on the African subpopulation. The samples are size 8,100, but we pretend to only have access to 800 of these 8,100 samples and want to extrapolate up to 10 times under fixed experimental conditions, so to be able to compare to competing methods. On the x-axis, we have the number of samples, and on the y-axis, the number of observed variants. We here display results from an early Bayesian parametric competitor. The estimator cannot account for power law type of behavior, and there are instances in which, when ran on real data, it provides degenerate results, as shown here. Our predictor in blue instead seems to provide a much more natural rate of growth. Because we have access to real data, we can compare to it and indeed check that it matches the true rate of growth to good precision. Via subsampling, we also provide a notion of calibrated uncertainty for this prediction. There also exist methods in the literature which do well in certain cases under fixed experimental conditions. For example, here we show the method of Zhou and Cawthers, which is a nonparametric frequentist approach based on a linear program. As you can see, it performs similar to ours and very close to the truth. And again, by performing the same subsampling approach, we can provide a notion of calibrated uncertainty. There are, however, instances in which this estimator can produce unreliable answers. For example, if we trim down the sample size of our training from 800 to 300, the prediction of the linear program changes dramatically, while ours remains robust and constant. This phenomenon seems to be common for smaller sample sizes of the training, N. Moreover, the linear program relies on a hard-to-tune parameter, which makes the prediction task less obvious. The last competing method we discuss here is an adaptation of the classic jackknife approach of Burnham and Overton for the problem of missing species, recently proposed by Gravel. The jackknife estimator depends on an order, which has to be chosen up front. Here we show the first order and lower order, first and second, seem to be suffering from severe bias. Higher order jackknives, however, perform very well across all datasets considered when experimental conditions are kept fixed. The fundamental limitation of this method, however, is that it's not clear how to adapt it to changing experimental conditions. And to show this, we consider a different subpopulation, the Korean one, and we here show the performance of the fourth order jackknife, which performs perfectly when conditions are kept constant, but provides a useless prediction when the experimental conditions are changing. Here we simulated realistic data in such a way that the training data was sampled at a known depth of lambda pilot, while the follow-up was sampled at a known depth of lambda follow. Our predictor still produces useful predictions because it takes into account this change, while the jackknife estimator does not take into account this change and provides useless prediction. We now show how we can use these predictions under changing conditions to inform optimal experimental design of a follow-up study. Here we show on the y-axis the expected number of new variants as we vary the sample quality, lambda follow. Points on the curve show feasible combinations of number of samples and sequencing depth given a budget and a cost function. And we see there is a clear trend in our objective. If we specify a very small sequencing depth, we'll be able to sample many more observations, but this won't be useful as the noise in such observations won't let us reveal many new variants. The usefulness of the sample keeps on increasing until we hit a maximum or elbow, after which increasing the depth is not beneficial. Our method can inform the optimal choice of these sampling parameters and in turn help maximizing the usefulness of the study. So to wrap up, we provided a new Bayesian nonparametric predictor for the number of yet to be seen variants in genomic studies. This is competitive with state of the art when conditions are kept fixed, but it's also the first method for prediction under different or changing experimental conditions, and it can guide optimal experimental design of future studies. Some challenges and limitations is that our method, as well as all the competing methods, relies on conjugacy. So it's hard to encode more realistic information, such as linkage disequilibrium. It need to be said that all other competing methods make the assumption that the loci are independent, but all the experiments are run on real data. So despite this independence assumption, our method is still useful. Some potential extensions is to go beyond binary count vectors and go to something like count value vectors, or include a hierarchical structure in our data, a typical feature of Bayesian models. You can check out our work on the archive, as well as early version on AAVI at NeurIPS 2019 and BNP at NeurIPS 2018. Thanks.